Thank you. Thank you for inviting us in this meeting. And I would like to explain the basic principles of the methodological line of market equilibrium models in particular. And the market equilibrium models have strong foundation on economic theory, on microeconomics. And I think it is important for all the future modeling teams to improve the microeconomic foundation of the modeling. And this is why I wanted to emphasize the history of this modeling and the basic principles of how to do it. And the history is that in the beginning of the 90s, in 91, 92, the European Commission decided to change the kind of models they have supporting in the past. And they have financed, it was the DG research of that time, in reality, financed deliberately market equilibrium modeling for energy, the environment, and the economy. This is when this E power 3 concept was born. This discontinues the older tradition of overall linear programming optimization models, and in the energy also some accounting models. The same thing happened coincidentally also in the United States, exactly at the same time. And these two streams of modeling thinking ended by the models of primes, GME3, poles. Poles is very much used, it was not mentioned before, also in the Commission, that it is the same line of thinking. The NEMS model in the United States and many others, including the model of the World Energy Outlook of the IEA. And this created immediately a series of periodical reports that Tom has shown already also. For example, this is in 10 years ago, World Energy Outlook, the annual energy outlook of the United States Department of Energy, and the European Energy and Transport Trends. And this is the picture of the same thing today. There have been every 2 years, in the United States every 1 year, and in the IEA every year, a periodical report on this. And this demonstrates the systematic use of these market equilibrium models. What is very important to have in mind is that the most important is the interaction of the modeling with the policy making. Because the policy making is continuously asking more difficult questions, continuously. And this is the history in the European Commission. The first questions 20 years ago were very simple. Now they are very complex. And they have been complex. And this is the basic incentive for the modelers to do scientific improvement of the models. And then the improvement is directly tested in the field, and that is this feedback is extremely important. Without this close interaction, only research on modeling will not be productive. And here is a long list of topics that the market equilibrium models used in the Commission, prime, GME3, poles, and some others, have addressed. You see, from liberalization of the markets, the emission trading scheme simulation, the energy roadmaps, the low carbon roadmaps, the 2020 package, up to the most recent winter package. This is, in reality, an accumulation of improvement of the modeling, at the same time, improvement of the thinking. And this illustrates the role of the modeling. And the role of the modeling is not to forecast, it has been said, not even to project. It is to support a process of learning for decision makers and for the modelers themselves. And this learning is the most important outcome. And let me go back to which are the common properties of the energy and economy and environment market equilibrium models. The basic principle is that the models have to represent the formation of prices explicitly, not implicitly. Implicitly is when the prices are dual variables of constraints, like in the old tradition of optimization modeling. But here, the pricing module is a separate module which determines the prices, and the prices are in the center of the inducement of demand and supply and the equilibrium of the markets. This allows to represent competition regimes which are not necessarily perfect competition. The linear programming was only perfect competition in reality. Then regulatory policies, for example, tariffs for the grids and many others. Policies which intervene and influence the prices. The efficiency of the markets, the distortions, all that are enabled by having the prices modeled separately. The second big property is the modularity, the agent approach. Everyone model, sub-model, represents the decision-making of an agent, of a representative agent. Either it is a demander, or a supplier, or a transmission system operator, or an operator of a grid. Whoever is that agent, is important to identify his own individual problem. The microeconomic foundation means that implicitly in his mind, he solves an optimization problem from which the outcome, the demand, the supply, whatever, is derived. Having a special model by agent allows to introduce specificities. Specificities mean embed engineering aspects, embed technical aspects, embed behavioral, embed market distortions, barriers. And these are very important for policy analysis because these distortions, barrier, influences of behaviors can be the topic of policy making, and we have seen many, many examples of this kind. And then the final property is we can also have the idiosyncrasies, the heterogeneity of the agents, because you understand one single household can be representative of millions of households, but in reality, the decisions are very heterogeneous. Having a separate model allows representing heterogeneity with various modeling techniques. At the end, the system is a system of market equilibrium, simultaneous for many markets, and the purpose of this market is to be descriptive, is to be answers of the type what if. It is not the type of normative models. Normative models are those that suggest what to do. But here it is descriptive, in the sense that we must have scenarios and draw conclusions from the comparison of scenarios. And so you will have the opportunity to see in the website the details of this presentation. I don't have time to go through into the details, but it is important to have in mind that this modular approach allows also to be realistic regarding the dynamics. The dynamics are important because in reality, there is never perfect foresight. There is never decision-making under certainty. There is always uncertainty and myopic or imperfect anticipation, etc., etc. And this is exactly one of the big merits of the approach, to be able to represent non-perfect anticipations and behaviors which are not in a certain environment. The same applies that I said again about competition. The approach includes what we call overall constraints and targets. You see, because you have these modules of the agents, the market equilibrium balances, then on that one can introduce targets. For example, greenhouse gas emission target, for example, energy efficiency target, renewable target, whatever. And there, the shadow variable, which is associated with the target is used as a price signal to influence the behavior represented agent by agent in the different submodels. For example, an energy efficiency value is a price signal to make residential sector renovate the houses, or the renewable value, it is as if there is a price signal making investors giving more value to renewable investment instead of something else. And then by iteration, by increasing and modifying these shadow variables of the overall targets, one can reach the targets. And this is how it has happened with the roadmaps in the, with the Commission, with the 2020 package, with the 2030 objectives, and the winter package. And it is not one single target, there are multiple targets simultaneously. And the explicit pricing allows introducing all these competition regimes, regulations, and distortions. There are three main approaches to implement market equilibrium modeling. One is the more complex one, the iterative modular approach. The module are in a system of iterations. Examples, primes and NEMS. NEMS is the United States model. Second line, integrated mixed complementarity problem modeling approach. There the model is more compact. There is no iteration because it uses MCP algorithms to solve the model. And here we have examples like the models by Hobbs and Gabriel in the United States. Hobbs about electricity market, Gabriel about gas market. The gas model in primes, the oligopoly power market in primes, which has been used in the winter package. The Tremove model for transport, and many, many others. There is an emergence of many, many models of the MCP type, which is called now MPEC, EPEC, different names, but the principle is the same. And then the third line are the, I call them the reduced form equilibrium models, which have the mathematical form of a system of equations. Why they are reduced form? It is because instead of modeling the decision making of an agent as an optimization problem, these models use directly a functional form which links the outputs and the inputs of this behavior, and this is the reduced form. You understand that this allows econometric estimations of these reduced forms, and these system equations formed by the reduced functional forms is a system of equations, which again can be dynamic and rich in terms of policies, engineering, distortions, etc. And these are the models POLS, Prometheus, the model of World Energy Outlook. And if you think about the computable general equilibrium models are in reality the same thing, reduced form system of equations like the GEMI3, the GREEN, EPA, and many others, which in addition have one general closure rule which is necessary for the macroeconomy to represent the closeness. The iterative modular approach, I will not expand because of lack of time, has all these merits of the modularity. Very rich representation. And the other very important use is that the modules are self-standing models. They can be used in applications separately from the entire system. Here is an example of the structure of the primes model. It is an iterative modular approach. The modules are self-standing. The pricing is explicit. In many places in this model, there is representation of nonlinear relationships, like the cost-supply curves, the learning-by-doing curves, the congestion issues. I mean, all these are nonlinear. And then there are the environmental and overall targets introduced, as I explained before, and the linkages with the macroeconomic and the world energy model poles. If you think about the NEMS model, has exactly a very similar structure and has exactly the same features. Modularity, nonlinear cost supply curves and learning curves, environmental constraints, overall, etc., etc. And there are always in these three approaches advantages and disadvantages. The main disadvantage of the very complex modular approach is the complexity. The long runtime on computer, the demand of a big team to support it, but the merits are obvious. It is the sophistication, the possibility to answer difficult questions, and the comprehensiveness. The integrated MCP approach means that the model represents the decision making of the agent separately as an optimization problem, which is transformed into Karush-Kuntanker conditions. And the KKT packages of mixed complementarity relationships are concatenated with each other. Then we add the equilibrium constraints and the overall targets. And this is a form which is a system of complementarity relationships, and the special algorithm can solve it. The pros is that it is a very compact and rigorous model. The cons is that it cannot be very, very complicated and large because of the limitations of the algorithm. Here is an example. And then the reduced form market equilibrium models have the disadvantage of being compact and less sophisticated, but the advantage of having econometrics and having the possibility to run quickly and on relatively small computers. So I'm just concluding with the new challenges that we are envisaging to develop, and I make the publicity now of our new research programs in 2020, which is called InnoPaths. And in these InnoPaths, with other teams, some of the teams are here, we aim at developing new features in these models. Like, for example, the full modeling of the integration of renewable, and in particular, dispersed renewables at large scale. The storage, and in particular, the chemical storage, the power to gas and power to hydrogen technologies. The investment under uncertainties, and more importantly, to model the behavior of prosumers, producers and consumers. And coordinates in a better way the interaction between the decentralization and the centralization, and the interaction between the electricity and gas markets. And also we have ambition to do much better in detail about the renovation of buildings and houses, about the transport sector, and in particular to improve the spatial features of the transport model, and the nexus with materials, biomass, land, and water. So the horizon is now 2050. The next step next year will be 2070 in order to study the years after the current horizon of 2050. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much. And again, an impressive amount of information in a short period of time. Thank you for keeping to that. While we go around and get the microphone to one, two, three questions, I'm going to abuse my position as chair and ask one that I always find interesting in this space. And that is, given the complexity, how easy or difficult, or can you make some comments about how to address transparency at the same time? Because I think that's a key issue. Maybe let's collect two more questions and then we'll take the other two. I saw four hands go up. So it's yourself next, and then over here, and then we'll move over there in the next round. So please.
Ruud Egging from Trondheim. One short comment. In the next months, I will submit a paper that shows that all the MCP models that Gabriel and Hobbs and I in the past have been working on can be solved as optimization problems. So the bullet point you made that it's not possible, it is possible. And I think it's a very interesting result that should be known in the broader modeling community. Now I have two specific questions. I'm enormously jealous of all the work you've done in the past on the modeling. But when it comes to the analyses, there's two aspects I'd like to have some comments on. First is, if everybody is doing what-if analysis projections, who is actually doing the forecasting? The other question is, the NEMS is also well known for doing yearly retrospective analyses of their projections and then learning from it. And when will the price modeling team start with their retrospective analyses? Thank you.
Doran Kelesh from KIT in Karlsruhe. As an economist, I appreciate your approach of a general equilibrium model, but I'm wondering how you solve the technical details and constraints in the model with a non-linear model, and don't you see a room for linear mixed integer programming and concentrating on the details of the electricity system especially? And my second question is on your iterative approach of different modules. I see the chance of modularization, but do you have a convergent value or does the iteration converge to a certain value that you can apply and reason the iterative approach? Or do you have interrupt for computational reasons and so on?
The transparency. Ah, yes. This is a very important question, and I wanted to give you my a very specific position on that, based on my long experience. I think that in reality there is a trade-off between transparency, openness, and quality of the model. I'm very frank about that. As an economist, I can say that always in the research there is that trade-off. Imagine the pharmaceutical industry without patents. Imagine many, many examples. I mean, the established theory of research and development says that research and development takes place and concentrates capital whenever there is a monopolistic rent for a while. Otherwise, there is no high quality research. That said, it leaves a lot of possibilities and room for openness, transparencies, etc. So there must be a trade-off. There must be a compromise. It is a populist argument that everything must be simplistic, open, and transparent, and everybody in the web can run it. It's a populistic, like in politics, in my opinion. So we need complexity. We need high-level mathematics. We need, at the same time, review, peer review, full transparency of the mathematics. In my opinion, full transparency and public data. It cannot be copyright on the data, in my opinion. It is not possible. But there must be copyright on the mathematics. And there must be opportunity for third persons to learn, to use it. But if it is something which is very simple and transparent, then there will be this will act to the detriment of quality. I appreciate this remark on the use of optimization algorithms. I also have examples of optimization algorithms that can solve mixed complementarity systems. And then there was the issue of the forecasting is a difficult job. Very difficult. A way of avoiding the forecasting is to do projections. Yes. However, I see poles as a good example of an econometric model, poles and Prometheus. I see some of the macroeconomy models which have econometrics, like the E3ME. So there are some examples of more or less, okay, I agree, but there is an effort. There is an effort. Good forecasting is with a few number of equations because of the complexity of the econometric. It cannot be a big model. Let me... Retrospective is very important, and it is a lack. I fully agree with you. We have to publish retrospective analysis.
We're running out of time. Let's just get to the next question.
Yes, the iterative process is successful, both in primes and NEMS. It is handled in a very robust way. We don't have...
Okay,
Yes, yes, absolutely. The both in primes, NEMs, and this model, in primes, for example, it is extremely detailed. There are constraints about the ramping, the technical minimum. It is mixed integer programming in the dispatching of units. It is a full power flow network. Okay, it is complex because of the modularity.
If I may suggest specific questions about some of the details, we'll take offline. One last question, and then we must move on.
Yes, I follow your work since many years, and your answer to the first question is a bit of a surprise. I come from the climate modeling community before joining the commission, and it's quite clear that in that community, models which are not open could not survive. Because of the skepticism, it was not about populism, it was about climate skepticism. They had to open not only the data, but the models as well. And that has become the rule. Do you think that the energy modeling community can stay in an island without opening, like just the others? I'm not sure.
The climate modeling, it's not a topic for partisan way of thinking. No, I don't agree. It's not partisan. It's not about whatever the rights of the women. It's something different. Okay, the climate modeling, atmospheric modeling, all these kind of things, it is very different from modeling economics, from modeling industries, and private entities. This is the difference.
So I think let's close this particular one off now. We are in fact over time, but we will at the end of the session, if folk would like, we can cut into lunch a little bit. But I would like to give the next presenter some time. Two quick points. First off, again, thank you very much for the presentation.